fuerza en el Señor. Nació Chos, Augusto, Sexy, Sexy.
Hello and welcome back to episode number 66 of the TNC podcast, and I'm incredibly privileged tonight to be able to welcome Dean Ashton. Yes, you heard that right. Dean, it's great to have you here, mate.
No, it's an absolute pleasure.
Thank you so much for coming along. When Chris said that you were coming along, I thought, what a lovely opportunity this is to chat to someone who I looked up to throughout my childhood, and sitting next to me tonight to go through a good time in Norwich City's history.
What do you mean childhood? You're as old as me, aren't you?
Well, yeah, have I aged slightly better too? Anyway, Dean Ashton, Norwich City, talk us through that time in Norwich City's history, in your career. What memories stand out for you repping that yellow and green shirt?
I think, obviously, coming through at Crewe, it's a relatively small football club.
Big history, though.
Big history, fantastic club as well, especially for bringing young players through and developing them. You know, the names that came through, it was fantastic. But for me to come to Norwich, obviously I'd played at Carrow Road before for Crewe, and a magnificent stadium. So for me, it was to come, felt like a huge football club for me to be joining, and it was going to be my first taste of Premier League football. And as well, I'd been at Crewe quite a long time, and there'd been a lot of sort of rumours as to whether I would get a move here or there, and nobody had really took a chance on me. So for Norwich to do that, it was just so exciting to be at a club like Norwich, where you're going to get 25,000 people there every week. You're going to be playing the Premier League, and the club have, you know, broken their transfer record to bring you in. Just all of it at sort of 21 years old was just fantastic.
And blimmin' please, we did break our transfer record.
To be honest, though, when I actually moved, I wasn't even thinking about the fact that we were right sort of down the bottom of the league. I was just so excited to be joining Norwich and be part of it.
Was there pressure on your shoulders becoming the sort of record transfer? Because you often hear from players, don't you? You're coming in and there's already that pressure on you. Was that going through your head, or were you simply a young 21-year-old with a massive opportunity and excited about the potential that you had?
I suppose I didn't really think about the price tag, to be honest. I'm a pretty inwardly confident person.
Okay.
I'm not like Hooks who lets it alone. So I'm quietly got a lot of inner confidence. So I knew I was good enough. It was a big step, and you know, you're going to be training with some top players. But as soon as I went in, first few days, I got absolutely battered by Phlegm, Hooks, all the players.
Because you were young, I think a bit of the
you know, whole record transfer, you know, just you just can't get. I mean, I was an awful trainer as well. I was really unfit, because at Crewe it was all football based, technical based, but we never did fitness work really.
So
we
were very unfit as a squad. It was just because
I used to have Mondays off at Crewe to sort of let myself wind down and stretch and all this. And I went to try and do that at Norwich, and obviously Phlegm and Hooks were just on me straight away.
Chris, what were your memories? You sitting in the Barclay with your dad.
Yeah.
Norwich City signed Dean Ashton. What's going through your head?
Well, there's three games that stand out for me. One is the Middlesbrough game. Your debut, right?
Was that your
home debut?
Yeah, home debut.
Mm. Of course, Drury with that goal to equalise. But obviously, Dean made a massive, massive impact in that game. The Man City goal, actually my favourite, which was that kind of that first time touch. Mm. And if that had happened in the Premier League now, that would have been just absolutely everywhere. Love
that. Hamstring trying to do that side one.
And I think the best has to be Manchester United. It doesn't, I don't think you can beat that. But it'd be interesting to see your thoughts on that. Is that your greatest memory? Is that the best goal you scored for us?
Yeah, because obviously, you know, with the age that I am growing up, Manchester United was the club. And it still was at that, you know, it still certainly was at that time. So growing up, you always wanted to play against an Alex Ferguson side, and you always wanted to play against Rio Ferdinand. I know there was some of the top names on the bench to start with, but you're playing against the top players, and then to be able to, you know, to win the game and obviously get on the score sheet and help Leon get his goal as well. It was brilliant.
What a goal. What a game. Loved it.
I mean, how do you look back on that Premier League season? Because it didn't end how we wanted it to. You then gave us a chance in the Championship. I mean, fond memories from Carrow Road, or what could have been, maybe, for the club more than yourself?
I think it's difficult. I mean, that defeat on the last day was just crushing. Yeah. I mean, we really felt as if we were going to get something out of the game. And
we you were made on, me cry we were, that day.
Yeah.
Seriously, I'm
me
not
personally, no.
Yeah. We only had to blooming draw.
I know, but we got off to a great start as well. Yeah. I should have had a goal that was disallowed. Leon, I think, should have had a penalty as well. Mm. We were a bit unlucky to start with, but then after that, I think obviously heads went down once you know you're out of it, it was difficult, and it obviously got a lot worse. 6-0, but then obviously it's a difficult part of my career because I'd spent a lot of time at Crewe,
yeah,
probably longer than I thought I was going to. Suddenly I got this taste of Premier League football. To think that I was going to have to go back and play more Championship football was difficult, and there was a bit of interest, and spoke to the club a few times, and you know, I was very, very grateful that they took the chance on me, and I wanted to repay that, and said I was more than happy to stay and see how we we got on in the Championship. I was a little bit disappointed that we didn't do some better business in that window. We lot, you know, the players that were on loan disappeared, and the squad wasn't as strong as I was hoping it was going to be. But we still had enough quality to do better than we did do.
I mean, that's fascinating you say that, Dean, because I mean, from a fan's perspective now, and the game has changed a little bit since you were at Norwich, but do you think players still kind of want to repay the opportunity they've been given, or is it more about personal gain? And because you could have quite easily taken another Premier League move that summer. I don't know if things would have gone differently, but you chose to stick with Norwich because they gave you an opportunity as that young player.
Yeah.
Does that still exist or not?
I think so. It really depends on the players. I mean, when it came to January, I didn't have that same feeling, and I went because you only get one career.
Yeah.
And you know, I wanted to play in the Premier League, and if I wanted to achieve the goals that I was set for myself or the dreams that I wanted to get to, I knew I had to move on sooner rather than later. But obviously in that summer, yeah, I did feel as if I wanted to repay, and I think there will be still players that would be like that, and a lot depends on how you've been treated and how much you enjoy. And I love being in Norwich. I love being around the players. We're brilliant, the staff, everything about it was great, and so it wasn't that hard a decision to stay. Plus they gave me a new deal with a little bit more money, so no, I was more than happy to stay and really give it a go that Championship season.
Chris, West Ham then come calling for Dean. How disappointed were you when our main man went?
Well, it was Malky, of course, went to West Ham as well, which wound me up a treat. But
I used to be wound up.
to be honest with you, I thought it was natural progression. I thought it was fair. If you look at, you know, I kind of, in a sense, I put it in the James Maddison box. I thought that it had to happen eventually. And I felt the same about Dean, so I don't have any kind of like, you know, anger against him. Fair play. As Dean says, you've got one career, one life, and why not? And I'm sure the West Ham fans will be thankful that he did make that step. You know, the other thing as well I've got to bring up, your overhead kick against, who was it in the testimonial?
Oh, for Mark Noble's testimony.
Oh, my God.
I love how you
had
to think about what overhead kick then.
Oh, my God.
More than one. I love
the fact you'd hung up your boots when you did that as well. It's ridiculous. I encourage anyone that's watching and listening to this now, YouTube, Dean Ashton, West Ham, Mark Noble testimonial. Banger.
But if you're as big as I am now, don't try it.
The lovely thing about that goal, you mentioned that, Chris, I think I've read it on the Telegraph, an interview you done with them a few months back, how much that goal meant to your kids as well.
Yeah.
When you went up to the stands, it was more than just a goal, wasn't it?
It was, because yeah, my kids obviously had never seen me play. They don't believe that I ever played football. You know, I try and tell my son that I played against Ronaldo, and he just laughs at me because now he just sees me as
an
overweight dad. So
yeah.
You know, so yeah, for him to come along to a stadium and for me to just do something like that, and then for the whole stadium to erupt and sing my name, he got really upset in the stand because he just didn't...
Wow.
Well, he didn't get it. He didn't understand that's what I did do, and I was good at it. So that was just a really nice thing
for
him to see, and especially the old one who's into football. I think the youngest was probably on his,
Game Boy. Yeah.
I mean, it's nice for you to come on a Norwich City podcast in your West Ham colours. what was that point in your career like? The England call-up comes, let's touch on that. I mean, it's been well documented, but just kind of talk us through them years, the England years and the injuries as well.
Yeah, I mean, I'd gained so much sort of experience just in a small time at Norwich. And then going forward then to West Ham, I really just felt like I was just getting better and better as a player and learning more about how to...
What's that feeling like, that confidence that you can do anything? Anything you touch just hits the back of the net almost.
It's funny. I think, I don't know about other players and other positions, but I just think as a forward, I mean, Jordan Rhodes showed it perfectly the other night against Villa.
Yeah.
He hardly touched the ball.
Mm.
You know, and that's what I always thought as a forward. I was never the quickest and... you know, so I was never going to outrun players, but I always just thought if the ball came to me in the right areas, I know I'm good enough to put it in the back of the net, and I don't necessarily need, you know, huge amount of chances for that to happen. So it doesn't matter who I was playing against, as long as I could figure out where the space was going to be and how to get around getting the better of
smart.
Them. If I got myself into a position where the goal was there, then I would have the confidence to feel like I was going to score. But then it's obviously learning how to deal with the best players and how to obviously assert yourself onto them players and work for the team, obviously. And my work rate needed to get a lot better. I was very lazy when I was at Crewe, and the boys at Norwich soon made me figure out that I needed to work a lot harder. And I took that forwards end to West Ham, and I just rolled with this confidence that I'd had.
Yeah.
And obviously then getting to the cup final, which was incredible, and to play probably what I would say is
the most iconic FA Cup final.
Well, and the best I think I've almost ever played.
Yeah.
In terms of, you're up against Carragher and Hupia, you're in a showpiece final. I felt as if I really delivered on the day. I'd been injured as well for 3 weeks leading up to the game. So I think to go in and play the way I did, I think was starting to really show what kind of level I could get to. And it's kind of that cliche where everything seems to be going perfectly in my whole career. I'd lost a load of weight as well after that final. I'd worked really hard.
It's just all about your mindset.
Yeah, exactly.
It?
But then football is just a blink away. I saw Ryan Mason the other day.
Oh, yeah.
I was chatting to him, and it's just all it takes is just one incident, and your whole career, your whole life can change. So, but yeah, I mean, to get even just to be called up to England, I know what happened, I broke my ankle, but to be called up, and the players that were in that squad were talking about, you know, some of the best names that we'll be talking about for years and years. The Beckhams, Lampards, Gerrards, you know, Rooney.
You completed it, mate, as they say. Completed it, mate.
Yeah, not quite. No, but there was definitely a gap.
What do you mean not quite?
No, but there was definitely a gap. I hadn't proved it yet, but there was definitely a gap for, you know, Shearer had obviously retired, and there hadn't been...
Yeah.
And Sheringham had retired, and sort of Heskey was getting towards, you know, the latter end of his career. So there was a space. It was Peter Crouch, it was Beattie, was looking like he was getting a chance as well. And I felt like I was in that mix to get a shout. And if I'd done well enough, which I felt I was going to, because after the cup final and staying fit, I thought, this is going to be my chance. And then something like that happens. But that's football and life, and you got to roll with it, sort of thing.
I mean, you kind of look back at it now with a bit of a giggle, and you must have grown a lot over the past kind of however many years it's been, to go from heartbreak to now looking back. And it seems, you know, you look back with fond memories rather than kind of what could have been.
Yeah, because it's as you come away from football as well, you realise how hard it is to make it.
Yeah.
And the tiny percentage of players that actually get to do what they love as a job. I mean, you know, now I've got my kids starting to grow up, and I'm thinking about, you know, what they might do as they grow up. And I think, what a job I have.
Yeah.
Well, it's not a job, is it? I was just going in playing footy with your mates, basically, where you're having a laugh, and you're getting to play in the stadiums that you get to play in. It's not a job. It was just fantastic, and only a small minority get to. Got lots of mates that didn't make it for one reason or another, and I did. So I think it's more got to look at that side of it.
100%.
And you know, I can, you know, I'm pleased with how I performed when I got to that level as well.
And Norwich City fans, I think we can both say, Chris, look back at your times with great memories. Let's move on to current day Norwich City. Chris, Sheffield Wednesday 0, Norwich City 4. We were top of the table for, 24 hours, but we were top of the table. That sounds nice though, doesn't it? A crushing away win.
I am stunned still, because I'm going into every game kind of cautious and saying, it's got to end. Surely it's got to end. And going away to Hillsborough and putting in that sort of performance is very, it's not like Norwich at all. And I think that just is a massive testimony to how well Daniel Farke has done of late. It's a testimony to how he set his team out, the culture and style of football that he's incorporating. I think it shows togetherness in the squad. What I'm liking the most, and we finally proved it in this game, is we can grab games by the scruff of neck and bully teams and rip them apart. And I don't think we've done that yet under Daniel Farke properly. And I really did feel like we did that against Wednesday. I was on my way to Manchester for a rave. We won't talk about that. But I was actually on the train at the time. And I was watching Mario's penalty, and I was shouting and swearing. And people were like, oh my God, what is this guy? And then when one goes in, I give it the little fist, and the second, and I'm up on my seat. By the fourth, I'm literally running up and down the train going, get in, you canaries! And the train is laughing and joking. But it's brilliant. And I'm just getting this sense of togetherness and this energy. And even if you look back at these times, we had this energy, this, there was just something special in the air. And I'm not over-egging it. I genuinely believe right now, if the supporters and the players keep this togetherness, we can achieve the arguably the impossible, because we've been written off. The pundits have wrote us off. The fans have wrote us off. I'm starting to believe now. And I'm being serious. And I know that you've told me not to get carried away, but I can't help it. You go away to Wednesday and win 4-0. Mm. They've got some big earners in that team. Big earners. That's a huge statement upon this league. Huge.
You said a few pundits have written us off. This man right here may have done it at some point this season, not breaking us off, but, and I agree with you, Dean, when you said, I think you said this on the EFL show on Quest with Colin Murray, that you don't think this team has enough depth in it to sustain this form, the fourth best form side in Europe at the moment. I think only PSG, Juventus and Man City are above us. We've picked up 25 points out of the last 30 available. Can we sustain it?
Well, I mean, they've shown they can certainly sustain it recently, and the reason I said that was because they were winning games by the odd goal. They were having to come from behind. I was thinking, you can't do that every single week. But they have managed to do it. And especially with that 4-0 victory, it has kind of, like you say, made a bit of a statement to say we're a seriously dangerous side. And again, I mean, again, it wasn't until the second half that we kind of really came alive. Mm. But the other reason I say that is you have got young players that are coming through, and it's really hard to expect them to stay at the levels that they are. I mean, they've been fantastic, the two fullbacks and Cantwell as well, who's come in. But even you look at Buendia's very young, Paslak's very young. So you've got a lot of young players that can be inconsistent, but clearly the confidence is just flowing through the whole squad. What did Grant Hanley getting injured, was that a mini blessing? Because the two centre-backs have been superb.
Yep.
And you've managed to keep quite a solid sort of team, especially that back four's been stayed together. So I just, again, you worry if there's the odd injury or suspension at the back, how's that going to affect the team? But at the moment, whoever keeps coming in is delivering. So, I mean, I watched them against Preston in the early part of the season. Honestly, it was awful.
It was
awful to watch. It was very much like last season where there was lots of possession. But now that confidence with the young players and the players that have come in, and that real competition for places is what you need. I mean, I really do hope they do continue, because it's actually great to watch now.
Oh, 100%. And Chris, what's changed? Because Dean brings up a good point there, and it was one that was frustrating me so much. We go back to that Preston game, and admittedly, we won that. But there were so many times last season when the play was so pedestrian, it was slow.
Mm.
And it feels like since Ipswich away, when I said if we didn't win that, Daniel Farke has to go, and people have certainly reminded me of that comment.
Fair enough. You can't lose to the worst team in the league.
No, that's fair. But what has changed since that point? I think it was Borough after then, and then since that moment, we've gone on to pick eight wins out of 10 games.
I think just consistency in the Championship is obviously key. I think the more you win, the better your mentality. And something that, you know, just to go back to Dean's playing days at Norwich, and for me, what was so successful and what worked in that period is we had such a strong spine to that team. A ridiculously strong spine. Greeno in goal, Fleming, Malky, Hux. Like, we had some amazing players. But more importantly, they were the first names on the team sheet. And now you look at it and you go, Timmy Krul, Christoph Zimmermann. And you go through it and you're like, Leitner. Up front, we've got Pukki. You know, I just look at those four now, and I'm starting to... Look, I might be getting ahead of myself. I think I might be still, but I'm finding it hard to resist. So I think that's the key point. I don't think... I think quite clearly the tempo has been worked on in training. I think quite clearly, I think Leeds might have given them a kick up the arse, actually. I think it might have bred some jealousy, perhaps, because Leeds came to Carrow Road and they schooled us. They played us off the park. And, you know, I was a wee bit embarrassed because I don't think we're that bad, but I thought Leeds just made us look like school kids. But since that game, for me, was the game that I think kicked them up the arse and made them think, actually, why can't we play football like that? You know, collect the ball and give it immediately. Buendia, absolute revelation. Absolute revelation. And I think that him playing in his current form, and by the way, he shouldn't even be starting, because you know, we've got some serious players on the bench. We've got Hernandez sitting on the bench. Handy's going to come back. He's not going to get in the team. For me, there's just nothing but optimism. I'm not going into a game now thinking, why can't we win this? You know, I'm honestly not. I agree with Dean's point. Preston, you look at that game and you thought, how are we going to win games now? Again, you know, if we were playing like that and coming against Millwall at home, of course, next game, I'd be like, oh my God, Millwall at home. But now I'm like, let's trounce them. We've got the ability to. Why not?
Team Ipuki, Dean, Chris mentioned there, and Jordan Rhodes. I saw you were with Jordan Rhodes a few weeks ago, handing him the shirt. How impressed have you been with them two players? Slightly different strikers. I think you mentioned you're quite a similar player to Jordan Rhodes. Do you see that?
Yeah, of course
I
do.
And then
you've
got a team who's a bit more, you know.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. Pukki will come a bit deeper and get involved and make a few more late runs into the box, and he's not quite as physical as Jordan Rhodes. Jordan's having to jump for every ball, fight for everything. He looks tired in a lot of the games because he's having to do that work for then. And nowadays, with that lone striker role, you have to do a lot of unselfish work and take the hits for the wide players to be then running in behind you and across you. But what he has got is, he hasn't got electric pace like I never had. He's not the biggest either, but get the ball in the box in the right areas and he gets a chance. The second goal against Villa shows what a great player he is and what a great striker he is, because that's just an instinctive finish that not that many players can have. And he's shown in the past, if he can get on a run, he can get you goals. But Pukki has really, really impressed me. I mean,
he's surprised you?
Well, his record wasn't bad. If you look at his record at Bromby, it wasn't that bad. You know, he's pretty much 1-2 last season, and it was better than 1-2 the season before. So that's a fantastic record if you're getting better than 1-2. If you get 1-3, you're not bad. So he clearly knows where the back of the net is. But again, when he first came in, I wasn't quite sure that he would be able to lead the line. But again, with the confidence of the other players and the movement around him, again, when he finds space, he seems like a very, very good finisher. And great to have two strikers fighting for places. That kind of gets the best out of you as a striker.
Because we've missed that in recent years, Dean, haven't we? I think that's probably been our downfall. We haven't had an out-and-out goal scorer. Which is tough.
I mean, Nelson Oliveira is a goal scorer, there's no doubt, but he's lazy. And so he doesn't give you... If he's not scoring goals, he doesn't give you much for the team, whereas the two at the moment, even if they're not scoring, at least they're giving you something as that centre forward, which you have to give.
What have you made of the man management of Nelson Oliveira? We had Nick Mashiter on last week who said he didn't feel that Daniel Farke could kind of control, but didn't want these big characters around the dressing room. Have you ever been in dressing rooms where there's been a bit of a fiery character? You know he can deliver on the pitch, but it proves a bit of an issue for the manager. And how is that kind of relationship between player and manager?
I mean, Craig Bellamy's been known to be a difficult man to handle. Freddie Ljungberg quite was, because of the reputation he had, and he didn't quite have the commitment that was required. I think what's difficult with any player is, I mean, people sometimes think from the outside and ask me about Hooks and say, well, was he a bit of a nuisance because he's so assured of himself? But actually, deep down, he was very much about the team. If you look at his assist rate, he's incredible. Very, very unselfish, considering the ability he had. He could have probably gone on his own many a time. Was very, very unselfish. During the, you know, in training and what have you, he could rub people up the wrong way. But he was the type of player you wanted. And I think that's Nigel Withen knew how to get the best out of him. Would allow him to have some banter. Even Hooks would even cane Nigel as the manager.
Really?
Just out of with banter, which was great. And he allowed him to be like that because he knew that would get the best. So it's about the manager knowing whether he can allow a player to be like that, if it's going to be okay for everyone else. But the minute that it annoys other players. So if I don't know this for sure, but imagine if players are looking at Nelson Oliveira and thinking, well, hang on, you're not really putting the effort in. You're trying to, you know, you're making out that you may be better than you are and not toeing the line. Like I said, I'm not, I'm not quoting anyone. But if that's the case, that can be difficult. And sometimes you just need players out of the way if they're not going to be part of what you want. And that clearly has to be the case. Otherwise, he's good enough. If he's put the work in training, you would expect him to get a chance again. But maybe he's not. I'm not sure.
100%. Chris, I think let's round this Sheffield Wednesday chat up, though. And let's give credit to Daniel Farke, because it has been an unbelievable turnaround. And even if, you know, we do fall a few places in the league, you don't see us falling off a cliff edge now, do you really, in terms of the way we're playing?
At least that no matter how the season goes now, you can say that we've been top, which is quite nice. I still expect us to get playoffs. I just think we're good enough. I have got that expectancy. I don't think we'll fall off a cliff. I think that we might have a barren run at some point. I'm looking at Christmas time particularly, and I'm thinking there's a lot of games of football there.
Tough games.
So I think that will be a real test. I think arguably that's the next big test. But apart from that, up until then, I expect us to be winning games of football. Simple as that. But, you know, the Sheffield Wednesday game is a statement. Simple as that. We're looking good.
I want to quickly go back chronologically slightly, and apologies if you're hearing bangs. We've organised a podcast night on fireworks night. Last week we organised it in the busiest day the brewery's ever had. This week it's fireworks night. So apologies. Fireworks on the pitch at Hillsborough and also here today. It was Carabao Cup night on Tuesday. We lost to Bournemouth. Now,
Dean, you were happy about that, weren't you, Jack? We lost.
I was really pleased in the way we had a fresh side on Saturday. Tuesday night, Dean, cup game. For a team like Norwich, how do you approach it? Is it seen as a hindrance because we haven't got that depth in squad that you've mentioned before?
It shouldn't be, no. Players are fit enough to play. If there was a league game suddenly scheduled for the Tuesday, would you rest everyone? You wouldn't. The manager wouldn't.
No.
He wouldn't make that many changes. But because it's the Carabao Cup, and because football and money rules in football, and getting to the Premier League obviously would be the aim for the club, the Carabao Cup is just set aside slightly, I think, by some clubs. If Norwich weren't necessarily in the position that they were in, and maybe lower down the league, he might have played a stronger side. So I think it is difficult for managers because their job is on the line. If they're not, if they're not doing things right in the league, and they're in a great position because of it. But I just think, as a player and a club and the supporters, really, when you get to that stage of a cup, surely everybody wants to. My best memory ever will be playing in an FA Cup final, and I'm sure West Ham fans, the latest thing they'll have remembered is getting to a cup final, going to the cup final.
West Ham were in a slightly different position than, weren't they, in terms of Norwich. The sole aim this season is promotion out of the Championship. Financially, that's the biggest thing. You mentioned that the way football is going financially, you know, the league isn't as important as it once was. Does that replicate into the players? Do the players realise that it's not as important as a league game?
I don't think players think like that. Players want to play. We certainly don't want to train more than play.
Yeah.
We all just want to play. If we can play Saturday, Tuesday, and just recover in between, perfect. Players just want to play constantly.
It's momentum, isn't it?
Exactly,
When you're winning games, it's momentum.
Yeah, but I just think it was a shame that we made, even though Norwich played so well, it was a shame that there was that many changes. Because actually, I thought with the Bournemouth changes, if we'd have gone a bit stronger, I think we'd have beaten them.
What do you really think, though, Jack?
Because
you said you wanted Norwich to lose that game.
I didn't say I wanted us to lose. I said I
wanted. Are you sure?
I'm really happy that the likes of Max Aarons were dropped. Looked incredibly fresh. Really happy that
you're
the
being
team
smug.
Of Cookie didn't start. And
the way you
two
put
goals
it about.
No. I'm really excited that win on Saturday lifted us to top of the table, and now we don't.
Can
have
you
any
understand? Can you understand? I agree. Well done. The league was great, amazing, but we still played exceptionally well.
We did, and that's brilliant.
Okay, but my point is, can you understand why people gave you stick for that?
Yes.
And are you accepting of that stick now?
Yes.
Excellent. We'll move on.
Magic Moritz. Now, first of all, thank you to the reaction on Twitter. I think this is a record-breaking amount of questions we've received, so we might not be able to get through all of them, but thank you anyway. Clearly a popular man, Dean. That can be a little ego boost for you. Magic Moritz asks, penalties, roll it into the corner or blast it down the middle? Now, I kind of want you back to take some penalties because Mario Vrančić can't take them. Jordan Rhodes can't take them. Why is it so difficult to take a penalty?
Well, it shouldn't be unless you're just trying to be clever and have a battle with the goalkeeper in terms of seeing where when he's... the best penalty takers, you have to look at the best penalty takers, and that was Shearer,
Rooney,
Letizier, Ricky Lambert. If you look at the best penalty takers,
what do they do?
They don't faff around. Yeah. And Harry Kane's a great example. He has two or three penalties max. Mm. They've all got incredible power, because power is what's going to beat a goalkeeper. And then accuracy. I only had two penalties, so I never ever went down the middle. I had run up as if I'm going to smash it and hard side foot it into that corner, which would be as accurate as possible. And I never missed that side.
Nice.
In all the penalties I took that side, I never missed. And then there's the one where you just run up and just look at contact and aiming for that side, which is the two I missed, which was one for Norwich against, I think it was against Reading.
Yeah, I'm furious about that still,
yeah,
by the way.
Still past the post. But so that one's a bit more difficult, I think, than just the straight. But it's just about getting two or three penalties and going with power.
Here is the secret sauce, and Dean's touched upon it already, and Southgate nailed it, right? You've got to own it. Yeah, Mario Vrančić fannied about. He didn't own it. Jordan Rhodes fannied about. He didn't own it. Shearer, he owns it. He smashes it. Yeah, that's exactly what you've got to do. That's the secret sauce. It's not difficult. Psychologically, you know you're going to smash that ball as hard and as fast as you can into that bottom right-hand corner, into the centre of the goal, really. Just blast it. Just own it. But don't change your mind. Don't, all of these pathetic little run-ups like Pogba, what are you doing? Mm. Own it. That's it.
Well, there you go. So the professional footballers watching, you've just been schooled by two fans.
Sub for Pouring Land Wanderers.
starter for Hemsby Hornets. Billy asks, what was it like in the dressing room after that Manchester United game when you scored and set the other one up? 9th of April 2005. Remember it well.
Yeah, it was incredible because when you look at them games, especially when you're down there, and it's difficult when you're down there not winning many games, and you look at the Manchester United game and you sort of think, the likelihood is, if you're being realistic, is we're not going to get anything from the game, really. It's going to be tough. If they play the best players, it's going to be even tougher. So I think to get 3 points against a team like Manchester United, I think just gave everyone just that massive lift of, actually, we can properly stay up. We're more than good enough to stay up. And that's what I felt in the dressing room after that, was that everyone really believed that we were good enough to stay up.
And you spoke earlier about when you were playing at Crewe and came to Carrow and sort of saw Carrow. I mean, it's not the biggest stadium in the world, but when that's full and it's rocking, it can be quite a good arena. I was watching them highlights back today from that game, and the Barkley just exploded, especially for your goal and Leon's as well. They must be such fantastic memories to look back on.
Of course, yeah. There's nothing. That's why I love being a striker, because there's no feeling or noise better than when you score a goal. There's nothing better than running over towards supporters and every type of person you can think of, from women, children, old men, young men, going absolutely ballistic because you've scored a goal. That's an incredible feat. That's an incredible feeling. So, to be able to do that in a stadium like Carrow Road, where, like you say, that old style stadium that really sort of keeps the noise, that was special.
Definitely.
As a Norwich City fan, that those are the games that make you fall in love with the club. I disagree with anyone that says, oh, I prefer the Championship because we will win more games. That's crap. You know, the games as a Norwich City fan that you remember is beating the big boys, because we always play well against the big boys as a whole, apart from Liverpool, but we'll ignore that one. Yeah, those are the games. So, I mean, and that's why I fell in love with Norwich City, and that's why I want us back in the Premier League, to have a go at the big boys that have got millions and millions and billions, arguably, to spend now. And, you know, that's what it's all about, 100%.
Can you remember any times from when you were playing at Poor England when the crowd just exploded?
Well, I do remember a time quite well, Jack. You know, came on as a substitute, as always, got the winner, roly-poly. kiss to the crowd, which happened to be an old lady by the linesman.
That
was a quality selling, mate. It's all about the roly-poly. I tell you, not a scratch on your cellos, mind.
Good. Lovely.
What was your cello, Jack?
I used to go for the Kevin Nolan celebration. I don't know why. I think I just watched Kevin Nolan Match of the Day.
Right.
I tried to replicate it at Hemsby Horn. It was me and Aston Oxborough, the centre-back partnership. His football career has flourished. Mine hasn't. Sat here talking and slagging off other footballers. Yeah, lots of celebrations. Too many from the countless goals I scored. John Killett asks, with Chris missing Saturday's game to watch City reserves playing Spain, which position does Dean think City could strengthen our squad in January, just in case anyone catches Chris's eyes over the weekend? Right, just to fill in our viewers, Chris, you're missing Norwich Millwall this weekend.
Yeah, I'm going on a scouting mission.
For some small team in Spain?
Yeah, they're called Barcelona.
Right.
I'm going to watch his play. He's been highly... apparently, he's quite like Wes Hoolahan.
Okay.
But not as good.
What's his name?
Lionel Messi. I'm going out there and hopefully I'll secure the loan deal for January. Quite excited to do that, yeah.
Good. Right, let's get to the question. Any position Norwich need to strengthen in January?
I would say midfield. If any position particularly, I just think still, you know, I think we could still do with more of... I think that number 10 role is still up for grabs.
Mm.
The one in front of Leitner and Tetti. I just think Stieperman's played in there and done okay at times. But I just think if we had that player that can really link, like you said, a Wes that's got that ability to really link that midfield and the attack. Because on a couple of games, you know, that has been missing a little bit, especially when teams drop a bit deeper.
Yeah.
We're just struggling a little bit to sort of link that a little bit.
And what about...
But they're very difficult players to
find. But Buendia can do that, right?
He can, yeah.
Yeah, Cantwell could do that, I think.
Cantwell's been flying.
Mm.
What about the strikers, dude? We've got two strikers at the moment, scoring goals. That is fantastic. Am I being greedy to say we possibly need a third? I know we've got Dennis Shrabeni scored at the weekend. A striker?
I mean, obviously, another striker would help. I don't necessarily think that's something we particularly need because there's goals out. There's been spread around.
Yeah.
A lot of players in this Norwich team, and I think the way we play is difficult for a striker. It's not easy for us. You know, having watched Jordan and Pukki, it isn't easy for them.
Could that be our downfall?
No, not necessarily, because I think the goals have been spread out, and I think the way the team play, it plays for definitely the wide players and whoever plays in behind the striker. So I wouldn't be too worried, to be honest. And they're both good goal scorers, you know, they're box players. So if that build up's good enough and the delivery's good, then good enough, then I think they will both get goals.
If the form continues, I wouldn't be surprised if we don't invest. And actually, to be honest with you, how I'm going to be satisfied out of the January window is if we just offload, get rid of Naismith, get rid of Oliveira, and I will be content with that, honestly, because I think that's going to alleviate a lot of pressure financially from the football club that will mean that we can crack on in the summer months. Look, if you keep playing like this, we keep forgetting, Dean touched upon it earlier about these youth players.
Mm-hmm.
We are literally playing, like, obviously now they're first names on the team sheet, but at the beginning of the season, they would have been playing in the cup games, right? And, you know, to see Todd Cantwell, you know, do as well as he is, why invest? Give confidence in the young players to crack on and deliver. Make them play more games. Max Aaron's against Wednesday, by the way. Just talk to me about that. Absolute dynamite from him. He is $1 million. And actually, another really important part about the January window is we need to seriously protect these players because Max Aaron's, Jamal Lewis, the Premier League big boys, will be knocking on the door. And I hope Weber's got that door locked shut.
That was a fantastic segue, Chris, because Tony asks, Dean, do you think Max Aarons or Jamal Lewis will get sold this January or next transfer window?
I'd be amazed if they went in January because I think they'll be enjoying themselves and they're playing. And do you want to leave that? When I was leaving, I knew it was because I was going to play.
Okay.
You know, it would be incredible if they were to be bought and play straight away in whatever team was going to buy them. So I think And I would advise against them leaving as well, because I think at the moment, playing regularly...
I hope you're listening.
You're in the spotlight. You're in a team that's doing well. It's got a chance of promotion. Yeah. To be part of something like that would be an incredible experience for them. But there's no doubt if they carry on in the summer, I think you'd be very... they'd do well to hold on to them.
Oh,
both
Dean, don't say that.
I'm sorry, that's just the way it is.
You spoke about playing. There was another question here. I can't quite find it, but I can remember reading it earlier. He said... What do you make of Remy Matthews and Angus Gunn, who Angus, of course, had a fantastic season with us last season, has gone to Southampton, hasn't quite made the first team. Remy Matthews thought he'd be the first choice keeper this season, has gone to Bolton and isn't playing. What's going to be going through their heads at the moment, getting the moves that they probably really wanted and not going straight into the first team?
I think they'll be frustrated. You know, players, especially young players, I think it is important that you play. I think goalkeeping is just... It's very much a different breed. I think you have got to be patient.
Mm.
You've got to wait for your opportunity. You've got to almost wait for your goalkeeper who's in the side to make a couple of really bad mistakes. So I wouldn't be too worried, but obviously it's just horrible because all you do is train for a game on a Saturday. Yeah. So then not to be on the pitch is difficult for anyone. And I was surprised actually that Angus didn't go straight into the team. So I'm sure he feels the same.
Yeah, I mean, I know Angus is frustrated currently, but I also know that Angus knows that when he gets his chance, he will stay in that team 100%. There's no doubt about it. And if you look at the games that Angus has played this season, he's caught the eye of the manager. If you look at the games that he has played, he's kept clean sheets in the cup. He's impressed against some of the bigger teams already. And for me, I think Dean's got a fantastic point there. It's just about patience, isn't it? I mean... Arguably, Remy's not been in the team because he's just not been good enough, Jack. So I'm pleased that Tim Krul's kept his place in the team.
Good stuff. Good to see Bolton doing really well without him. Ollie Baines asks, and we spoke about this last week, how long does City leave it before handing Daniel Farker a new contract? Daniel Farker's contract runs out this summer. A few months ago, we were all questioning whether he'd have much of a future here. Now, he's probably one of the most valuable managers in the Championship. The conundrum Norwich City have here is big, isn't it?
Yeah, of course. And I think, yeah, even at the start of the season, the way we started, yeah. I think there would have been questions as to how long can this carry on. But I think what's impressed me about him is that he hasn't panicked. He's kept to the same style of football, yes. Whether that's good or bad for anybody, or whether supporters would start to moan after 20 minutes because the football was turgid, but actually he's stuck to it and the players know exactly how he wants them to play. And now with his confidence, we're starting to see that style. So it wouldn't surprise me if there's talks already going on behind the scenes, and certainly when you get around Christmas, whether that's, but you know, it's kind of in his hands now. When you get down to that stage of your contract, I would have thought it'd be up to him.
Chris, you said last week you wouldn't hand him a new contract right now. Has that changed?
Yeah, I wouldn't do it right now. I wouldn't. I think it would have to go horribly wrong for him not to be handed a new contract. I think he deserves a new contract. I just think it's a bit early. Have we peaked too soon? Some of the sceptical Norwich fans might say that. For me, I'm still just being cautious. You know, Christmas is bloody tough for any football team. So look, if we can get through Christmas unscathed, still in the playoffs, 1,000,000% give that man a contract. What I like about Daniel Farker right now is he just seems to get it. He's just doing all the right things. He's learned from his mistakes last season. It was too pedestrian last season. We weren't direct enough last season. You know, we weren't taking our chances last season. I think it's such a small thing, and I'll keep mentioning it because I keep wanting him to do it, and it seems to be working. It's so good that he's just coming over to Norwich fans. He's shaking all of the players' hands. He's coming up to Norwich fans, last man off the pitch, and he claps those away fans. And that is $1,000,000. That is exactly what you want your manager to be doing. And I think that, look, as long as he keeps it up, it's amazing. And I love that Parker as well. Farker. You've converted me, Daniel Farker.
It's interesting you raise that point, Chris. And I think it's a big thing in terms of players coming up to the fans at the end. Daniel Farker especially, I don't think he'd done it last season, but he's really kind of embracing the fans at the moment. When you were playing, Dean, did you understand the amount it meant to the fans in terms of that little applause at the end goes so far?
No.
You didn't?
Had no idea, no. I mean, I think I always found it difficult anyway because I wasn't a supporter as a kid.
Right.
So I didn't support anyone. I didn't go to football as a kid.
Why was that?
Because none of my family were into football. So I never, it's not like my family took, you know, you might have your uncle or your brother or your dad, certainly, or your mum, take you to football. I never had that. So I never really got a fan's mentality. I didn't understand why that would ruin people's weekends, like, ruin their week.
It does.
and consume them the way that it can do. I never ever understood that. But I always wanted to be respectful in terms of, you know, going up to supporters that had travelled, certainly. But if I was in a mood or I hadn't scored or we'd lost or whatever that may be, that it sometimes that'd go out of my head. It wouldn't. I wouldn't think, oh, I need to go and make sure I go over and see the supporters that have just travelled. Now I've finished, I understand.
Interesting.
I understand what they sacrificed to travel, you know, a full day's worth, the cost of what it, to come and just watch us play, and then we just turn around and leave the field because we're in a mood because I haven't scored. I understand now that that's the wrong thing to do, but you're in a little bubble as a player, and it's sometimes you forget that. And now I've come out of it, I realise that I was probably not the best.
I hugely respect you for saying that, Dean, hugely. And what is what's really interesting is I actually think that that probably helped your game, because I think that it gives you that ice cool kind of like, actually, there's just no pressure. Because I'm going to be annoyed with myself. I'm not annoyed for others. It's my responsibility to perform. And I actually think that probably helped you. But I respect you for saying that, because that's
But now I've finished, you realise how special them times are. And actually, if nobody turns up, what is it? It's just you playing a game of football with nobody there.
Yeah, yeah.
It's obviously the supporters that make it. If you score at Sheffield United away and there's a pocket of 1,500, 2,000 fans that have made the journey up, that should be special, and you should enjoy that with them, but you forget that as a player sometimes. It's only now.
Take note.
That's really interesting.
You can appreciate it.
Jonathan Parker asks, if Dean could have his football career over, what would he do differently?
I'd be fitter. Okay. I'd eat properly. I'd train properly.
What's the worst grub you had?
I was honestly a disgrace.
Go on, give me your worst meal.
Well, I had a curry every Friday night.
Oh, jeez.
When I was at crew.
I write that.
Me with the family.
What's your go-to curry?
Just a chicken balti.
Chicken balti?
Yeah, okay. Nothing too hot. You know, if I've got to play the next day, you can't go too hot.
Yeah.
That was for Saturday night.
You don't want to be doing a Jason Punchin, do you?
No, you wouldn't know. No, and also I was drinking a lot as well. I'd go out Saturday night.
What's your go-to drink?
Oh God, it used to be half a lager and a Smirnoff Ice mixed in when I was
younger. Gracious, I did not expect that.
Yeah, but now it's just a fresh lager.
Yeah,
now I've grown up a bit.
Smirnoff and beer in one. Yeah. I've never heard of that.
I think that might have probably to be the title.
I've got a sweet tooth. So,
what was the go-to club if we're going down this route in Norwich?
Oh, it was Mercy. That's where I met my wife.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hello.
She
VIP?
She used to have the clipboard letting people in.
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay.
So,
there you go.
She obviously let you in that night.
No, she custard pied me early on, but then she was told she had to let us in.
Amazing. It was clearly the Smirnoff and the beer that done it. Then.
Once I went in, got a couple of them down my neck.
so you would be a bit better with your diet and your fitness.
Oh, totally. Yeah. I said, once I got to Norwich and you know Hooks and Flem and all the likes were taking the mick out. I mean, I realised how fit they were, because they were training properly and eating properly. I thought, well, what? I've wasted 5 years of my career not eating the right things. And I'm big anyway, so I needed to be trimmer and fitter. And as soon as I realised that, that's when I went from being a good player to a really good player.
But it doesn't strike me as the fact you were doing it because you could and you knew it was wrong. It kind of feels like you did that lack of education.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, again, at crew was fantastic. It was about the football, but they were probably a bit behind in terms of nutrition and fitness. That was only just coming in towards the end of my crew career. And that'd be the only thing I'd probably change, because I think it would have made a difference to me as a player.
Stay off the Balties, kids.
Get on the Balties. Saluting Shrebeni asks, now this, Dean, just to fill you in, this is a man who's made an account solely around Dennis Shrebeni. He loves the man. He asks, can we get through this podcast without Chris dissing Dennis Shrebeni? Surely got to be praised for a goal 43 seconds after coming on at the weekend.
You know, I think I should carry on. I think I should carry on dissing him because he keeps delivering. The more I diss him, I mean, look, put it this way. I've got this fantasy, Jack.
Oh God, okay. I don't want to know.
Ipswich come to Norwich, and Dennis Rebeni scores in the 90th minute to win the game against Paul Lambert and celebrates in front of him. Oh my God! Everything about Dennis Rebeni says no, it's not going to work, but it does. And I had a little giggle to myself. I was watching the highlights. And even still, like, you know, give him his due. He put the ball in the back of the net.
It was an awful finish.
He still managed to almost bugger it up. Now, we can giggle now. He put the ball in the back of the net. He gave it the salute. I didn't see him smile still.
Nice.
But look, long may it continue. Is he fit to wear the icon hat? That's the question that I want everyone to answer in the comments of this video. Is Dennis Rebeni fit to wear the icon hat now?
Well, let's ask Dean. Are you a fan of the snapback? Do you like a hat? Can you wear a hat?
Have you seen my head?
Look, are you saying you want
the size of it? No.
Are you saying you want to cover the ball bus?
No, I can't. It won't fit properly. Even the big snaps don't fit. They like squish into my big
head. If you're a footballer and you were...
What do you mean, if you're a footballer?
No.
What's a footballer?
If you were playing right now, and say you were substandard, below par.
Yeah.
Yeah. Would you walk around wearing an icon snapback? It says icon on the front.
I would if I, because every player thinks they're quality.
Thinks they're an icon.
Yeah, and they think every single player thinks they're quality.
Have you seen the icons?
Dennis Rebeni will think he is the nuts.
Yeah.
Oh, he will. There's no doubt.
Well, he is. But he is, though, isn't he?
He is now scored.
I mean, look at the icon hat. Look at that cap. It's strong, isn't it? You're loving it,
pulling
yeah?
It off, yeah, absolutely.
Well, at least I must admit, I think the icon snapback is better than Tim Close's Instacrass snapback. Mm. What is that all about? Mm. Look, fair play, Dennis Rebeni. What a performance!
Just a quick one, Dean. Man bun, yes or no?
Of course.
Oh, really?
Ooh. Yeah.
I wasn't expecting that from you.
Well, I haven't got hair, so if you can you do stuff with it. Hair. God, I've got
a lovely
beard,
though.
It's fine. Thanks. Yeah,
that's
the only thing I can grow.
You rock it nicely. Right, let's try and find some other questions. Right, Nathan Henderson, three-part question. Right, this sounds complex. What has changed from the Leeds game? We've kind of answered that. What do you think we will win the rematch against Leeds in February? And will Leeds bottle it? Now, you've been on Quest a lot, watching all of the EFL. What have you made of Leeds this season? Bielsa ball, as they like to call it.
I've been well impressed. Yeah. To be able to, there's still a lot of the same players from last season. So to be able to implement the style. But what's impressed me is their work rate. I don't know whether you've seen the video where there's about seven players all...
It's like a pack of dogs.
Yeah, exactly. All chasing back against Wigan. That just shows, that clip alone shows you what the manager's done.
Yeah.
And if they keep that mentality... then I think they will go up automatically with the quality that they've got. Kemar Roofe obviously is a quality player. So,
but it comes back
and keep them fit. And Hernandez, they'll be great.
And you've said it about Norwich. I've said it about Norwich. The squad, we've talked about it a lot on this podcast. Leeds have arguably got a thinner squad than Norwich, playing arguably a more high intensity style of play. Can they sustain what they're doing? Or will Leeds be falling apart again?
It's difficult. I think when you're saying falling apart, I think we're talking more about a mentality thing. So as long as they believe in what the manager's doing, which they seem to be, as long as they, fitness-wise, they can keep it going, I don't see why they won't overpower most teams. And I think that's what we're doing at the moment. We're overpowering teams with our fitness levels in the second half, with the way we're keeping the ball and making them work.
Mm.
And as they're tiring, we've got young players like Max Ahrens that made Sheffield Wednesday look as if they were running in treacle the way he just burst down the right, because he's young, he's got the fitness levels, and because we've kept the ball for most of the game, they're tired, and that's where we're making the most of things in the second half.
Definitely, 100%. Right, let's quickly look ahead to this weekend's game against Millwall. They sit 19th in the table, lost to Brentford at the weekend. That was Thomas Frank's first win in charge at Brentford. Surely got to be another win, hasn't it, Chris?
It's got to be. And again, I go into this game of, come on then, boys, prove it in front of the home fans. Prove it. Let's smash another team in front of the Barclay. Beautiful. Yes, please. Do it. Deliver.
And Dean, confidence will be high after, you know, the argument has been this season, we're only winning games by a one goal margin. You go to Hillsborough, 4-0 win, you come back to 26,000 in front of Carrow, and players are going to be up for it, aren't they?
Of course they are, yeah, and they're going to be looking forward to the game. You know, when you're winning games, you just can't wait for the next one to come around. Millwall, it's not going to be easy because they'll have watched how Norwich have been playing, and they'll have a tactic to try and stop them, and they'll probably play deep and try and counter like most teams probably will do. But the only thing I would say about Millwall is it's unlikely that they'll go for like three at the back, five across the middle. Mm-hmm. It's unlikely they'll play like that. They tend to be a more 4-4 and play with two strikers. Mm-hmm. So I think that would play into our hands quite a bit with the movement we've got and the formation that we'll play. So I think, again, if I'd be looking at this game, and if I was to go and put some money on, I'd be looking at a second half victory, but comfortable.
There you go.
Maybe 2-0.
There's the tips. Get on it with FansBet. Chris, I've only watched one Millwall game this year. That came against Ipswich. They bossed them 3-0. Let's quickly talk about Ipswich. They're still rock bottom. They're 5 points adrift. Paul Lambert hasn't won a game yet. I know he's only played one game. Are they going down?
You know what I find really entertaining? That Ipswich fans, having just watched them scrape a draw against 10 men Preston
with an outfield player involved,
For some reason, they think they're now going to get the playoffs. They are all deluded. They're all deluded. And I'm loving watching the rot. I think it's beautiful. And look, Lambert will keep them up. And that'll annoy me a little bit. But here's hoping that they go down and rot.
You've watched a lot of Ipswich this season with your punditry. I saw Matt Holland really having a go at sort of the current regime on TalkSport a few weeks ago. Not the current regime at TalkSport, the current regime of Ipswich on TalkSport. What have you made of their just complete capitulation this season?
I think they've made it so difficult for themselves because they've allowed all the goals they had last season to leave the club and not necessarily brought in equal quality. They've brought in players that possibly towards the end of this season, next season, will prove to be good enough, but you can't just get rid of the likes of Waghorn and McGoldrick, you know, ready-made goals, and expect then, if you don't bring the same quality in, you're going to struggle. The rest of their team, they've got some young players like Norwich have, but it's very difficult as a young player to come through when the team's struggling.
Mm.
You know, it's hard. It hits your confidence quite hard as a young player. So I think that's his biggest job, is to try and pick these young players up, Paul Lambert, and he'll have to try and bring something in January. I think until then, they're still going to be down there and struggling, I would have thought.
Definitely. Right, to finish this, one-word answer. Are Norwich City going up this season?
Oh, no.
Dean?
Well, I think they'll...
One word.
Go on, say it.
No.
Oh.
There you go. Thank you very much, Dean. Absolute pleasure, mate. Thank you so much.
No, cheers, pleasure boss. Coming in. Thanks for having me.
Watch him on the EFL, listen to him on TalkSport, all of that good stuff. Anywhere else you want to plug at the moment?
No, that's fine at the moment. I'll be all over the place.
When are you going to be playing in the Ryder Cup, by the way?
I need to get a little bit better. The problem is I need a few shots to play with, because then when you come up against the other footballers, they're just cheating.
I see. Yeah, thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for listening. A massive thank you to Max on the audio and also on the camera. Not so much of a thanks to the people letting off fireworks outside. Subscribe on iTunes and YouTube. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.